That's me. I'm around 9 years old in this picture. But this film isn't about me. It's about a place that helped thousands of boys and girls grow up to become functioning young men and women. A place where they learned how to laugh, cry, fight, make friends. A place to live in the true spirit of America. Where the person sleeping next to you could have been black, white, Jewish, or Muslim, and you still call them your brother or sister. It was a microcosm of America. That place was called Happy Valley. To understand how a place like Happy Valley could exist, we have to go back to the beginning, to the spirit of why there was a Happy Valley. It all started in an area in Lower Manhattan that was known as the Five Points. The name Five Points was derived from a five-pointed intersection. The Five Points was uniquely American. It was arguably the most diverse neighborhood in the world in the early 1800s. It was home to newly freed slaves, Jewish immigrants, Irish, Italian, and Chinese that came from California because of the Chinese Exclusion Act. It was also rampant with crime, drugs, homelessness, and prostitution. The Five Points is alleged to have sustained the highest murder rate of any slum in the world. According to an old New York urban legend, the Old Brewery, an overcrowded tenement on Cross Street, housed more than 1,000 poor. It is said to have had a murder a night for 15 years until its demolition in 1852. On one of his visits to the area, Charles Dickens described the Five Points like this.
This is the place. These narrow ways, diverting to right and left, and reeking everywhere with dirt and filth. Such lives as are led here bear the same fruits here as elsewhere. The coarse and bloated faces of the doors have counterparts at home and all the wide world over. Debauchery has made the very houses prematurely old. See how the rotten beams are tumbling down, and how the patched and broken windows seem to scowl dimly like eyes that have been hurt in drunken frays. Many of those pigs live here. Do they ever wonder why their masters walk upright in lieu of going on all fours, and why they talk instead of grunting?
There were many organizations and programs created to address the squalor of the Five Points. One program that was instituted was the orphan trains.
So these trains would load up, and from 1854 it began, and it went on for 75 years. And over 273,000 children came out of New York City. There were other trains running from Boston, Philadelphia, and Chicago, and we actually don't know how many children left from there. But the true scope of the orphan trains can be anywhere about the transportation of 400,000 to 600,000 children over a 75-year period. You have to remember, a family of five would leave New York City on a train, and two would be picked up in Texas, another one in Oklahoma, and then another one somewhere, the other two somewhere else. So these children were sometimes named after the people they were taken in. Other people just left them with their common name. So the orphan trains started off with the American Female Guardian Society, who were temperance women. And then you have 20 years later, you have Charles Loring Brace, who's a Connecticut minister, appalled at the conditions of the children and deciding to do something. He starts the orphan trains, help him. Well, Happy Valley itself was started by a group of temperance women who got together in 1853 and actually bought an old brewery and established a school, a home, a church, and a place where kids could stay. A lot of Happy Valley kids would go on to Spring Valley High School and be there, a lot of their sports stars, their runners. One of the kids, Jimmy Ashcroft, left Happy Valley High School and went to Florida A&M, and for a short period, he was the fastest man in the world.
One other organization that was formed was the Ladies' Home Missionary Society. This organization was created to help alleviate the hard conditions of the Five Points. They purchased an old brewery and helped form the Five Points Mission House of Industry. The building housed a chapel, a training school for mothers, a dispensary, and a day nursery. The conditions in the Five Points were brought to a breaking point in 1909 when an outbreak of diphtheria forced the Ladies' Home Mission Society to escalate plans to move the children from the Five Points to the country to live amongst the fresh air and nature. In 1911, 288 acres of farmland from the Happy Valley Farm in Pomona, New York, was donated to the mission by a trustee member named William Church Osborne. This was the beginning of Happy Valley. Over the next 20 years, many cottages were built as the population at the farm continued to grow. The children helped build the homes under the supervision of the staff that included master builders and masons. The early life in Happy Valley was set up to be as close to a normal home life as possible, with two house parents in the home and meals that were cooked in the home by the house parents and the children. The children also had daily chores, and the older children could work outside of the home. The boys worked with the maintenance men, and the girls would help in the offices. As the country was going through the ravages of the Great Depression, Happy Valley was pretty much unscathed because there was also farming and woodworking, which made them somewhat self-sufficient, which helped them get through the Depression. Yet, they still received children in need.
My father abandoned his family of six boys during the Big Depression. The welfare folks took the five of us to live at Happy Valley: Norman, Erling, Wesley, Delmore, and myself, Arnold. I was the youngest. I was between 2 and 3 years old. I remember the subway ride there, but the rest of the trip escapes me. I was placed in a cottage which held about 15 small kids like me. Mrs. Kaufman was the house mother. She had a wooden leg and used a cane. She was kindly, and I realize now what a terrific responsibility she had. I moved around to several other cottages. At around 5 or so, I was taken to Bluebird Cottage and was with 12 or so kids my age. One other move was to Woodland Cottage, where we had plenty of freedom until Mrs. Jacobson took over. She was very strict, and she sneaked smoke. We all knew it. And eventually, we stole cigarettes from her. She put me in charge of the kitchen stove and the cellar furnace. Both burned coal. I learned the big furnace by trial and error and became quite good at it. I also was the cellar boy, which meant I had to peel the potatoes every morning. One time I used a paring knife instead of the paring tool, and for lunch that day, she had cooked the thick peel and they were on my plate. In defiance, I ate it all and asked if there was any more, and I ate them too. You went to work after school at age 12. You got off the bus from Spring Valley High School, changed your clothes, and reported to the adult in charge. The boy shoveled sand into the dump truck. I did some furniture repairs and various jobs with Mr. Mills, who was a carpenter, cabinet maker, wood carver, landscape architect, and headed up the snow shoveling gang in winter. He smoked Bond Street tobacco in his pipe. He also taught classes in woodworking, which was very useful to the boys later in life. His wife was a sweet, gentle person who knew the kids had no home life. My brothers started to leave Happy Valley one by one. My older brother Norman left to go live with my father in California. My brother Erling ran away. That left Delmore and myself at the institution. After some time, I landed in the same cottage as Dell, and it was the first time I lived with a brother since entering Happy Valley. We smoked his pipe together and hung around each other, and life looked better. But then Dell was sent to Staten Island, and I was devastated by being left in Happy Valley by myself. I hated everything and everyone, and then I sank into a depression. I figured this out for myself not too many years ago. About a year later, I was called to the admission building by Dr. William H. Mandry. The superintendent asked me if I wanted to go live with my mother or my father. There are many things I recall about Happy Valley. First of all, it was misnamed. It wasn't happy for the wee kids at all. Mandry was a mean person who ruled with an iron fist. This would have been okay if Happy Valley was for bad kids, but it was not. To be told to go see Dr. Mandry was a very scary thing. He kept a thick paddle in his office and would make the offending kid bend over the armchair, and he got whacked severely. But there were many good adults and kids there, and I remember a few to this day.
In the late 1930s and early 1940s, Americans were called to war, and the boys from Happy Valley answered.
For Christmas, they used to ask us, pick three things you like. And when we were only received one thing out of the three things, and it was like sort of enchantment, really lovely.
And I met this family called the Slapitis, and they were like German, like Polish. And I babysat for them for a couple of years. On Saturdays, I would come and clean their house for $1 an hour. They fell in love with me, and they had 5 children. And in the summer, I used to go with them. They lived in New City. I used to go with them for the summer and be what they call a mother's helper. And when I was like 15 or 16, I believe I was in like the 11th or 12th grade, and they took me to live with them on a permanent basis because they love me.
Christmas time, we all used to go, I don't know if Jimmy and the other folks talked about it, we used to go to the Elks Club, to the gym. Yeah. We used to have a man come and do magic shows. It was the same magician, and it was the same magic every year. But we didn't care. We didn't care. It was there for us, and we enjoyed it.
Two things that were memorable to me at Happy Valley. Graduation, Mr. Henriksen was there for me. My mother and my father did show up. It was the first time my father has been there in a long time.
I mean, I came up from Queens, which was the urban area, and I just remember getting up and walking around in these woods. I guess there were woods at that. I don't know what else to call them. And being scared by, like, pheasants. I never knew. I'm from Queens. I don't know what a pheasant is. Wow, this thing would take off. And I'm thinking, what the heck? What are we doing here? And I never experienced any of that. I kind of grew to enjoy that kind of freedom and, you know, just the being able to, like, connect with nature. And like, the guys I lived with, we're into the same thing. We get up and we go out into the woods from 8 o'clock in the morning and come back at 7 o'clock at night.
There was that rec hall in the bottom of the main house. There was a little hall. There was the main house. And then at the bottom there was a basement. And my mother also ran the Friday night youth group or some Friday night social. And everybody would come and play music and dance.
My nationality is Filipino and Lithuanian.
I'm Arabic.
Okay. I mean, as a child, I don't think I realized there was a difference between the different cultures that came there. So it was a really good thing. And then as I went into high school and college, it just, especially during the turbulent late 60s and 70s.
And we grew up with all different nationalities, and everybody was our brother and sisters. I never looked at anybody saying, gee, he's different than me and she's different than me. Never. I grew up like they were just like they were different flowers.
Like my friends was Arabs. My girlfriends that I grew up with Arabs. My girlfriends I grew up with Irish. My girlfriends I grew up with Italian. So you tell your children that everybody is the same.
So when I went out to the world, you know, I love people, and I think it's because of Happy Valley, and we grew up with all these different race and nationality. I think it was wonderful, absolutely wonderful. And in fact, the whole world should be like that.
Jimmy Ashcroft.
Really?
Jimmy Ashcroft, when he was in high school, he was my idol. And I remember when he would be out practicing his first track events, and he used to run up and down the street, and he had set up a dash course where he had the blocks, and he'd run and time himself running down the road. And every once in a while, as I was a little girl, and he'd let me run with him, and lots of times he'd let me beat him to make me feel good.
Jimmy Ashcroft, he is somebody who I look up to.
He says, you know, had the world's record for a week. It probably wasn't even a week. It might have been a couple of days, but it was back in those days when Jesse Owens ran a 9.4 in the 100-yard dash, and I ran a 9.5. So you can take it like that. And then when I went to college, I went with Bob Hayes, who was at the time the world's fastest human. So I went to Florida A&M where he was, and we became great teammates and friends.
There was one house mother, Miss Pat, who was a very cool, hippie-like woman, and she did a lot of stuff with us and took us a lot of places and read and, you know, tried to integrate reading and books with us. So, you know, I would say she definitely was somebody I remembered.
I would say Miss Lynn, our house mother. When I went, I might get emotional.
It's all right. It's good.
Yeah. But when I went into one cottage, and it didn't work out. So Miss Lynn made space for me at Ford, and I went over there, and I stayed there until I left in 1970. And I choose her because she taught me how to nurture and how to love children.
I love Mr. Hendrickson. He was like a dad to me, and he showed me love.
I would say Mr. Kearns. I would say Mr. Kearns. I'll tell you why, because he used to be a health teacher up there years ago, and I was in the classroom one day taking in, and I always made sure I did my homework. So one day he came out and gave me an F. And I said, how the heck did I get an F? I said, when the guy over there got an A. He said, no. He said, but next time you won't let the guy take your homework.
I might as well talk about Debbie's mother and father because they were very influential in my life. I was aware that I had a mother and father, but I guess those years, formative years, they, just by example, taught me that, you know, how to accept love and caring. And as I got older, I understood even more that they shared their most important
possessions
with all of us. So, you know, and so that's, you know, just, I don't know. You know, I've always thought about how I would speak about your mother and father. And Honestly, I don't know what to say.
Mr. Henriksen and Mr. Kearns helped me a great deal. And like when I left Happy Valley in the seventh grade to go to the Spring Valley Junior High, I went out for some teams, and my grades were pretty good. I still had to work. I remember teachers helping me, and even up into the high school. But my first pair of sneakers that were really something to me, and track shoes, Mr. Kearns's brother had a shop in Spring
Valley.
That's
right.
He took me down there, and I didn't have any money.
That's right.
Benny Kearns.
Benny Kearns in the Main Street bought me a pair of U.S. kids.
Most interesting person is Mr. and Mrs. Burns. Mr. Henriksen is very good. And Mr. and Mrs. Frank Morello, they were a good inspiration for me. My teachers was Mrs. Akeley, mostly Mrs. Akeley, and Mrs. Broadhurst at that time. They were my best teachers. I was abused a couple of times over Happy Valley, and I learned I have no enemies about these persons. I forgive them all what they have done to me.
We did get the hell beat out of us by a couple of really crazy house mothers. And
Miss Patterson with the switch.
Yeah, she used to make us go out and get our own switches and beat the hell out of us. And yeah. I remember Debbie and Dawn Mills were there when she would do it too, but she spared them, I guess, because she would have gotten in trouble.
I think for me, the only negative was being separated from my brothers. They lived down the hill. I lived up the hill. But in a way, it's also a positive because it made us want to be closer, and we've been close since then.
Kids. My father took us to the office on Cross Street, I believe, in Brooklyn someplace. And this nice man and woman took us in a little car, me and my sister. So we went to the country. We didn't know where we were going. We just went with them. Mm. And I mean, anybody could have taken us. We would have just gone with them, you know, and not even ask questions. I didn't ask about my brothers, my sisters, no nothing.
Did they go? I do know that my mother is Japanese. She and my father was African American and black, and they met in Japan. And my mother and my father had my mother come over with my oldest sister.
My brothers were already there for a few years, and my mother remarried and actually took up another relationship, and then she. They had businesses and they couldn't handle me at home, so they sent me to Happy Valley with my brothers.
I came to Happy Valley when I was 11 years old, so I believe that was like in the late 50s maybe.
And I was in Happy Valley from 1970 to 1973, towards the end of 1973. And I wound up in Happy Valley because me and both of my sisters who were older were taken away from our mom, and we ended up at Happy Valley.
My father was Walter Henriksen, and he was the assistant director and then became the executive director at Happy Valley. I was born in Nyack, New York, and moved to Happy Valley as a baby in 1952.
I learned how to cook, clean, sew, socialize with people. I had some skills that taught me how to be a parent because we had structure.
Saturdays, like Pete said, we all had jobs, whether you worked with Albie Mills on the dump truck or you went into Mr. Mills, his father's shop, which I was privileged to go into with Ronnie Fiorelli. And I learned woodworking, which I do today, you know.
I was there my entire life except for the 4 years that I went to college. I also worked there in the summer times in the recreation program. I did the swimming, and ran the swimming pool and used to take the students or the kids on trips and what I would call my brothers and sisters.
I mean, like I said, you had your good times and your bad times, but I enjoyed it.
Wake up, little sparrow. Don't make your home out in the snow. Don't make your home out in the snow. Ago, your friends flew south many months ago. You're just a babe, you cannot fly. Your wings won't spread up against the sky. Your wings won't spread up against the sky. Your home.